Hi everyone, it's a girl Elizabeth, and really quickly I'd like to share a couple of things with you guys, and I hope this will bless one or two persons out there. Today's video is titled Tit for Tat. Do me, I do you. These are familiar phrases with us, especially when we have to deal with people who don't necessarily like us, in quotes, enemies, haters. You can experience them in your place of work, in school. It's almost like they've made up their mind that, see this girl, see this guy, I'm going to do everything possible in my power to make sure that I bring this person down. Some people even go as far as that I kill this person, that I get this person out of the way. In our life, we've definitely met people who don't necessarily like us, who have a hard time loving and accepting us, or we ourselves have met people who we have a hard time loving and accepting. Like, you will never have everyone in the whole wide world like you. It's just how humans are. Matthew 5:54 actually admonishes us to love our enemies and pray for those who persecute us. So I'm sure even when you read that scripture, you're like, okay, God, I've heard. So somebody is outrightly in my face telling me that he hates me and I'm supposed to love that person. That is what God expects of us. 1 Samuel 24, that is our anchor scripture for today. David had a real enemy who was hell-bent on having his head. From the day David killed Goliath, Saul could see that God was with David. Saul could see that David was anointed, and he became threatened. He became insecure, and he was hell-bent on killing David. There's even a point where Saul was so close to catching David and killing him. But luckily for David, news came to Saul that the Philistines were in their country and Saul needed to go and take care of that. So that kind of made Saul turn back and face something else. And David breathed a sigh of relief. I'm sure he was like, ah, thank God. But in the end though, do you know that when Saul finished in his city, he came back after David? Talk about stubborn enemies. On the journey, he needed to maybe take a leak or have like a bathroom break. And then he went into this cave. And unknowingly to him, that is the exact cave where David and his men were hiding. And he was left open because he was vulnerable. The men that were with David encouraged him. They were like, ah, see opportunity. God has delivered your enemy into our hands. Ah, you have to go and use this opportunity and kill him now so that we'll stop hiding. We'll stop running so that we'll have peace. David actually almost took their advice. He ended up not taking the opportunity to kill Saul. He just cut a piece of his robe and let Saul escape. What are the lessons we learn, and what are a few things we can extract from this whole situation between David and Saul, and how can we apply it to our everyday life? I'm sure by now you're thinking, if it was me, I see somebody who hates me, I have opportunity to deal with the person, or the person enters my trap, I will not let the person go. I will for sure get my own pound of flesh. I know people who are like that, and you're watching. I mean, you're right, because in all fairness, you read the story, like, this chase was already even tiring. So the point to note here when dealing with people, conflicts, enemies, or adversaries is to be careful not to accept advice that may hinder or prolong reconciliation. Be careful not to listen to that other friend of yours that's saying, if I were you, I would never in this life, I would never, the person would never go scot-free, I would deal with the person if it was me. Be careful not to accept advice that will hinder or prolong reconciliation and growth between you and those who oppose you. To try handling things with patience and humility. Next application we can extract from the case of David and Saul and how David handled that situation is he actually made the first move to reconcile. How crazy is that? Saul had even killed people who helped David. After everything that had gone on, David still chose to make the first move to reconcile. I'm telling you, even when you're right, even when you're justified, you can still choose to make the first move to reconcile. David actually ran after Saul to clarify things and resolve the situation between them. This is how we should approach our enemies and those who oppose us. Sitting back and waiting for those who oppose you, your enemies, those who have wronged you to make the first move is actually natural, because you're like, it's not my fault. You're the one who hates me. when you're ready, come and meet me. But the truth is, if you decide to take that step, which is actually very, very difficult, I'm not even saying this as if it's something that is so easy. Even me, that is even sharing the video, is something very, very difficult. But the great thing is, you can do everything. I always say this scripture. This is my Philippians 4:13. That's my favorite scripture. There's no difficulty in life that I don't apply that scripture to. God will actually give us the strength and the courage to move towards our enemies if we ask. If you read chapter 24 of 1 Samuel, if you notice when David confronts Saul, he actually states facts to try to clarify things. I don't know why you have this notion in your head that I'm trying to kill you. I'm not, because just now, see the piece of your robe in my hand. You were vulnerable just now in that cave, and I had the opportunity to kill you, but I did not, because that is not who I am. That's not what I'm about. I have never been about trying to kill you. You see what David did there? David humbled himself. David approached Saul. David clarified things. David gave evidence to clear up things. David explained things. And immediately, in doing that, he disarmed Saul. Even assumptions purely based on paranoias, insecurities, can cause a person to hate you just because. And that is why you must seek to clear and resolve conflicts. Because the longer a conflict festers and grows, the more slanted the views become. What starts as a small point of contention can actually become a major misconception. So the question is, who are you avoiding that you should pursue? Are you waiting on them to move first? Why don't you go to them, clarify the situation, and gently confront what has turned into a huge misconception? Now go. You may be ignored or refused, but at least you tried. C.S. Lewis said, "Everyone thinks forgiveness is a lovely idea until he has something to forgive." I can totally relate, because I have actually, in my life, I've actually had to forgive some really, really horrid things that have been done to me. And that only happened through God's grace and help. Really, sit back and think about it. All the times that you chose foulness for foulness, you chose tit for tat. How did it go? Okay, you got your pound of flesh. I need you to think about it. What exactly did you gain that was so much better than you reconciling with that person? David and Saul's story and how David handled the situation makes David a good example for repaying evil with good. Though if you keep reading down and you get to 2 Samuel, like all humans, David did some terrible things and he wasn't always the perfect model. There's a perfect true king, and his name is Jesus Christ, who pursued us by dying on the cross and rising in our place. We were enemies with God, but he resisted harming us. He moved first by sending his son to the cross to die for us, and he is now committed to our good in all things. I hope the story of King Saul and David, and how David managed that situation, and how David was able to resolve that situation and bring about reconciliation, has blessed one or two persons out there. And I hope anyone struggling in any way, I hope God gives you strength, wisdom, and courage to take the bold step to get that reconciliation wheel rolling. I hope God helps you. Have a great rest of the week.